What up, everybody? It's the Well-Spoken Token, and I'm happy to be here with you guys today. On the show, we've got a guest. We've got the beautiful, the wonderful Ty, Blaque N Kulture, on the show. She's a dope, multi-hyphenate photographer, videographer, podcaster, and just an all-around nerd and an otaku expert. Her socials and links are going to be in the description, so you can check her out at any time. Miss Blaque N Kulture, how are you feeling today?
Transparently, I've been feeling like crap the last couple of days because, you know, not COVID, thank goodness, not COVID, but just, those one-off colds. But today, I'm feeling pretty good. I got my tea plus a little extra in my cup. I'm in my fuzzy jacket. You know, I got my little heater at my feet. I am feeling pretty toasty.
Okay. For those of you watching, you see how she's looking. You see the beautiful butterflies. You said you're feeling toasty. I'm in my hoodie. Thank you, Tokyo Dreamers. Shout out to y'all. Y'all make beautiful merch. All that good stuff. But, it's comfy season. Are you in the midst of all this crazy winter storm weather, like right now?
No, I am in middle of the Florida. So definitely, it's like, what is it? It's like maybe 75, 80 outside. It's hot enough to where I was like, ooh, I need to turn my AC back on.
Which is, that's terrible that you were feeling so bad when the weather is like so decent. That's what's bad about that. I'm feeling fantastic, but I'm in Texas and it is chilly. It's a little bit chilly. Like, we are looking at like sleet and snow in my area.
Ew.
Who knows if we're gonna actually get it?
Gross. Weather. 0 out of 10. Mm-mm. No. Weather. Absolutely not.
So yeah, no, I'm bundled up. I gotta stay warm. Heat on like a mofo. I've got a little something in my cup, but you guys know me. I just like to drink. It's just how I do things. But today, Ms. Blaque N Kulture, I wanted to have you on today because I was looking for somebody who was going to be able to have a conversation with me about young adult fiction. It's a staple of my life. It's something that's molded me. Like, when I hear voices in my head, that sounds bad. I'm not schizophrenic. But like, outside of my ancestors speaking to me and stuff like that, I'd be hearing the author's voices or characters' voices. It's a very important part of my life. And I wanted to talk to somebody who's obviously done episodes, talked about the multiple reading things. So I'm like, yo, this is definitely the person to come to.
Oh, yeah. Not just a manga comic book expert, but I do read actual books with limited images.
I heard that. But hey, look, I was actually going to talk to you about that as well. Like, so like, obviously I'm an avid manga reader now, but I hardly ever pick up like a hardcover, like cover to cover, just words books. I have not read an actual book in probably 6-7 months. It's been pretty bad. I've just been like kind of like in a distance. I read all the manga catch up every week, but I just can't find myself like sitting down. When's the last time you read a book, like a whole cover to cover book?
A lot of my, strangely enough, a lot of my reading, since I would say probably around that 20 mark, I moved from hard books to online reading. So the last time I read a full book, I think I read, I'm trying to figure out what book was it. I have a pretty long reading list, and most of it's comics. So I'm trying to think of the last actual book. I can't think of it. I know it was like a German translated book because I like foreign books.
Okay.
So it was pretty decent. It was a zombie book. I just can't tell you what the title is. I'll have to look it up. But other than that, I read a lot of fan fiction. I'm an avid fan fiction reader. So I guess maybe that counts as books. If it's not, I don't care. I'm counting it as a book. So fight me. But I love fan fiction. And aside from me rereading the same 3 books over and over again, that's typically where that's the last thing I read in the last 2 months.
Okay, but it's significantly earlier than I have. But I like that you kind of mentioned that you're reading fan fiction and stuff, because like, I was gonna pose the question, because I read tons of manga, right? I read articles, things like that, online via my phone. Like, do you think that maybe the draw away from like hardcover books and like straight to like, do you read mostly on your phone, or are you reading on your computer? Like, what do you read on?
Me personally, well, I have like 2 separate like worlds. So like, manga and comics, I have to have physical copies. I'm a pretty serious manga and comic book collector. If you've ever happened to stumble across my TikTok, I think I have a TikTok where I show my entire shelf. So I love collecting manga and comic books, but books I don't mind reading online. I just think that it's for me. Books typically don't last as long on my shelf, and when I did my first big move into my first apartment, a lot of my older books that I've had for years were just falling apart. So I was just like, if I could find it online, I'm gonna find it online. I just feel like I'm not really an elitist when it comes down to books. I feel like if you're someone who reads them online and that's better for you, then you should collect it that way. But if you're like a fanatic where you have to keep the physical copies, I totally get it. And you should do it that way too.
Okay. I feel that completely. I actually went through a very similar experience moving. Like I had a great ton of books. Like I'd been gifts over the years, things that I'd picked up. You know, I had my own little bookshelf. And then in the move, I got a storage building. And then that storage building, you know how it goes. You know, you don't always pay the bills all the time. So stuff gets taken. They auction it off and somebody's like reading your copy of Othello. Like, who knows who that is? Like, that would be one of my favorite plays. But so I lost a lot of my books probably when I was like 22, 23. And so it's just a situation of, dang, like all the things that I amassed and I don't really have them anymore. And so having my phone or having my computer or laptop ready or around, I was like, oh, well, I can just read like all this manga. And I ended up pouring all this time into books with pictures and stuff that I kind of like dove off the deep end with the actual like reading.
Yeah. And I think that, you know, I know this is about YA, but I think one of the main reason that people have diverted into pictures, I feel like there's a lot of stigma around people reading. Like my personal opinion, I think that like when we were younger, at least like the millennial, maybe early Gen Z era, like there was a lot of pressure on you to read and be literate and like make it. If you're on a sixth grade level, you should be reading like at an eighth grade level. And if you're at an eighth grade level, you should be reading at a 12th grade level. And I was definitely that kid. I absolutely read books way above my level because I love to read. But there's like a lot of stigma there. Like, what if you're dyslexic, or what if you just have overall a comprehension issue and like you can't really, the words are too small or whatever the case is. Manga and comics provide a wonderful alternative. You can still get all of the amazing stories, but now you get they're pictures now.
Illustrated. And that's remember, and there's also a weird stigma about illustrations in books, like graphic novels, things like graphic novels, comic books, manga, like, or manhwa, like all of these things can be looked down upon because they have pictures. But the thing is that there's not any less consumption of words. There's not any less consumption of information or knowledge. It's literally just like, hey, this is also animated. I was going to say that stigma situation like applies on so many levels with kids. Like, were you a GT kid, like gifted and talented? Did you get placed in like all the like, oh, you're so special and smart classes?
Yeah, I was special and smart in everything but math.
Okay.
So
yeah, same here.
Right,
I was a gifted and talented kid, so like we can share that experience. You notice how like they segregated us? Like they stuck us in this, like all of you guys are in one class. We were pretty much I don't know if you moved around a lot, but like my experience was I lived in a small town for most of my schooling. So I was with these same gifted and talented kids all the way through lives. Like I met other kids that were just as smart as me, but because they didn't like end up in this bracket, like they didn't get that same thing. Do you think maybe, cause you know, we got praised and like validated for like reading. There was always prizes, like you can go on field trips and different things like that. Like, do you think all that praise drove us to read more during that time?
I would say I did definitely have a different growing up. I did move around quite a bit when I was a kid. However, because I was always labeled as like gifted and hyper talented, every time I went into a classroom, I was always the smartest person or one of the smartest people in that classroom. Like, people would ask me for my test scores, people try to cheat off my tests, all that good stuff. And for me, reading was more of an escapism thing. The person, like, I definitely think that when you put in the system where you have to be the best or you're always gifted, there is this enhanced pressure that you have to perform a certain way. And in books, and in particularly fantasy, I was not asked. I got rewarded for it, but it, for me, it was just, I get to a moment to escape into this fictional world where, you know, there are dragons, or there are large spiders, and there are princesses. And it was just really fascinating. And I actually my mom confiscated books from me all the time, because I would read books instead of doing like work, or instead of doing schoolwork. I was a huge book nerd, so for me it was definitely escapism.
Okay. I can certainly see that. I spend a lot of time my cats are going crazy. I did get a bit of validation, right, of being young, black, and gifted and talented, right? Like, right. Every time I was caught with a book in my hands, like, there was just like, oh my god, he's just so well read. Right. And I mean, like,
right, look at this little Negro go. Look at this. Look at their mind.
This little nigga is smart as fuck. Like, he can go. Like, hey, we dropped him.
He's so articulate. I just love the way you talk. You really can't sense the hood in your voice at all. So crazy.
You're just not like the others. Like, you're one of the good ones. And so I preyed upon that. Like, I dove into a lot of reading and things. Like, even my cousins would be like, yo, I always remember my cousin, he always had a real thick book on his hand and a couple of white girls. And I'd be like, I don't know if that's how I wanted you guys to look at me crazy like that. Like, by the way, I love you. Show, we all know I love black women. That's not even in the play. Like, I always have to just make these jokes and stuff like that. Because, like, yes, my current love of my life, I love her to death. She's Caucasian, so it's just like, all right, cool, like, I get a lot of stares. So it's like, dang, yo,
you advocating for the black community with a non-black partner. Absolutely. That's crazy.
Look at you, well-spoken token. You really did warm up to the whitey, didn't you? So yeah, no, like, I love it though. It's kind of fun. It gives me ammunition for all sorts of stuff. But it was like, was it ever like a cultural thing for you when it came to the reading situation? I mean, I understand escapism, absolutely, but like, did that ever come into play?
Oh yeah, definitely predominantly white institutions. For it wasn't until I want to say maybe fifth, sixth grade when I finally went to my first, like, there is more than white people, because for majority of my schooling, if I was a black kid, I was one of like one or
three,
two
or
three or four, and they were all sporadically spread throughout the grade. But my first time interacting with actual like black kids who are part of the culture, it was total culture shock. And like, it was, for me, it's that moment when you're looking at everybody like, what, you don't like to read? You don't just casually pick up books to read? What is wrong with all of you guys? Nah, we're all doing the soldier boy.
Exactly. Hey, look, I'm
doing the crank back.
What are you talking about, bro? Like, and that's like, hey, look, because like, the culture was, what was so wild is the culture was I say different because they were separating us. Like, they literally, like, they only put like two or three of us in there. Like, and so you got to wonder, it's like, dang, I know I was actually smart, but like, is it affirmative action? Did I just roll the dice right? Like, did I talk to the right person? But
oh yeah.
And like, some of the kids didn't luck out like that. So their culture is different. It's not worse. And like, going back, like, growing up, I guess the only black friends that I had were my cousins. Like, right, like, I had like family and stuff like that. I would always see them and stuff like that. So I was able to participate there. But at school, it was a whole different thing. It was like, yo, you're white. And so
yeah. In my household, I was the oldest of all of my cousins. I was the oldest daughter, so I was the oldest. So basically, I've, you know, all my baby cousins and my little brother, I had them all around me. And it was so funny, like, looking back on memories of me growing up, like, my uncles were they were real hood. I'm not even trying to mince words, like, boys. And my uncle used to try to teach me how to roast.
Oh, they were like, you can't just
I mean,
all right, hold on, I got you. I'm gonna give
you
easy target, right? And I'm gonna see what you got.
No, I don't. I refuse.
That's no problem. I'm gonna put the cap back on, guys. I might
all I'm gonna say is
for a different reveal.
I can roast if you talk to my friends, like, I hate to plug myself, but if you listen to the Good Kulture podcast, if you listen to them, I mean, the last episode, they absolutely roasted me to bits, but in private, you know, if you ask Space Lloyd, a amazing streamer, great friend, he will say I roast him all the time. But I have a rule about roasting, and my rule is I always keep it surface level. So if we have to have like agreed upon rules, so like, if I mean, for you, you know, your hairline a little crazy, you know, that's between that's not a roast, it's just facts, it's the truth. It's, you know, you and God gotta talk about that, that's okay. You know, they make keeps. It's supposed to be, you know, help. Maybe you need resources.
I can't get the sponsor. Like, I'm trying.
Maybe you need resources, and that's okay. But that's something that you agreed upon.
You're going to roast me, and then you roast me. You're killing me here. Blaque N Kulture came on the show. Guys, she came on the show. She said she came friendly, and she brought a gun. She brought a gun to the deal, guys.
It's a very small gun. It's a water gun, barely hurting.
Spritzing me, all right, and it's spritzing my soul. It hurts. It hurts my insecurities.
Oh, nah, no,
it's fine. Everybody knows I rock this hairline. If it wasn't for my brother, he would be like, my brother always is like, "Yo, put the hat on. I don't know what you're thinking."
Oh no,
put the hat on, bro. I'm like, all right, cool. Yeah. So, all right. Sorry, we went on a diatribe there, but. So your uncles always tried to teach you how to roast.
Yes,
right?
They always tried to teach me how to roast.
Yeah,
it was terrible because then they just sat there roasting me for 10 minutes. But
I love when old niggas try to teach you stuff. They're like, come here, listen. Well, were they avid smokers, like cigarettes and stuff, or like?
Nah, they were just, you know, at the time, I'm thinking relatively, maybe they were in like their mid 20s, like, because most of my family's fairly young. So like, they were maybe in their mid 20s, but whew, they used to rag about me, talk about the little snot bubbles in my nose, talk about, you know, how, girl, you don't brush your teeth, because of course kids don't know how to brush their teeth for whatever reason. I don't know why as a child I thought that was okay, but it's whatever.
Sure.
You know, they just like to roast you, and then you just take it. But I didn't really learn how to roast until, I want to say, probably like my junior year in high school. And the only reason why I had to get good at roasting was because I got really, really embarrassed at a small little gathering of friends. And this one guy, tall dude, really skinny and scrawny. I don't know what your name is, sir, but if you're out there listening, I'm on your ass. But
ass boy. He's on your ass, boy.
But he roasted me so bad from top to bottom. But my pride would let me cry. So okay. I just opened up and I opened the clip, I popped it in, and I sprayed him down. And it was the first time that anybody had heard me say something so vile and so rude. They're just like, wow. And then from there, like, basically I went on my villain arc, and I was absolutely the worst person.
She can rock you on a Himiko toga in the building, like,
oh, you know, I was absolutely the worst person for up until I had second year of college.
I had my worst person phase way earlier than that. I was like 16. I was like, oh, I'm a terrible individual. But no, that's awesome, that's fantastic. So let me ask you something. Were there any characters, right, in novels that you read, right, that would have influenced this villain phase?
You know what? I'm trying to think of someone who, like, really would influence me from novels.
Okay.
You know who I really identify with? And this is absolutely terrible. Like, okay, he's a terrible character overall. Like,
let's go.
I have the books right here, so I don't forget. But it's one of my favorite series. It's by Sherilyn Kenyon, and it's called The Chronicles of Nick. And essentially, in this series of books, it talks about this boy who always got beat up on, always got bullied, but he has, like, basically this ancestry and this power of, basically, I guess he's like the son of a Satan conduit, and you kind of watch him, like, become more evil and become more twisted. And basically, also, there's a plot line, like, where his future self is talking to his past self saying, hey, if you choose the wrong path, you're gonna end up just like me. So it was interesting, like, watching him make strategic moments in his mind where like, nah, today I'm gonna be nice, I'm not gonna be like the future me. And then there are other days he's just on demon time, and it's just like, you know what, today's the day, boy.
I'm on your ass.
And like, maybe it was the bullying aspect, because you know, like most black kids who went to PWIs and then had to go to a black school, of course I got bullied. Who didn't get bullied?
Hey, it's a part of the culture. Black culture is out here like, we get bullied, yo.
We get bullied. It's a part of your character arc. So of course I got severely bullied. And reading the books as I got older, I think this was the first book I ever purchased too, with my own little monies. So
little jobby job, or was it an allowance?
Nah, it was more like, you know, everybody got that uncle that just kind of slides you money in your hand off to the side. Like, don't tell your mama.
I give you $5. Here you go. Here you go.
So it was just a whole bunch of slide money that people had given me that I finally collected. And the book was like $14. Oh, yeah, absolutely.
Bricks.
It was so nice. And that character definitely influenced a lot for me. A lot of the other characters in books I never really associated with.
Okay.
Just because, like, a lot of, I definitely loved, like, of course, YA novels, they always have, like, that strong female protagonist, so, like, Divergent and Hunger Games, like, those characters, I know they're supposed to, like, identify with me, and I guess in some sense of, like, being a strong young woman who kind of had to take care of other people, I definitely understood that, because being the oldest, I definitely had a lot of younger baby sisters and baby cousins that I was very protective over. Okay. But those just didn't hit for me. Like, I remember reading Hunger Games, I'm like, girl, what is you doing? Baby, what is you doing? You saw you as tribute? I don't know. I'm gonna be real with you.
I don't know if I'm a volunteer. How many siblings do you have?
I am one of four.
Okay.
I have an older brother who we don't really talk as much, but he's cool people, so I think he's all right. I have my baby sister. We're closest in age. We're exactly 1 year apart. She is literally, I cannot talk the most about her. I know she's probably doesn't want me.
Gushy.
Oh, yes. I love my baby sister.
Talk about
her.
Baby sis, watch the show.
She's an amazing artist. She's a colorist for a project that I've got coming up. She's absolutely adorable and perfect in every way. And then my baby brother, who is also the light of my life, he's like 14, so he's like the one I have the most age gap with. Super, super bright kid. Just absolutely, I dote over my baby siblings, so I love them wholly. So just even still though, I'm gonna let you know, post-apocalyptic dystopia, whatever the case is, I am not being tribute for nobody. If they called your name, that was for you. God had a plan for you. It was in your plan, and that's you, bro. They ain't got none to me, baby. Ah, dang, mom, sorry. Looks like you gotta reproduce again. And hope you didn't tie your tubes. Gosh darn it
is nasty for tying tubes. That's what's up though. You gotta make more, like, get on your Medea, the woman that ate her children, like when I killed her kids. It's like, I can make more. Like,
listen.
That was some gangster stuff back in literature back in the day.
You gotta do what you gotta do. But okay. I mean, I think that overall there was one other story. I just can't think of the name. I couldn't even, but the basic description is because, of course, I think everybody can see I'm a little chunky. And there was this story about this fat girl who in the story, like, everybody in her family hated her. Which, if you're a fat person, you definitely go through a lot of, like, body dysmorphia and you feel like shit because people don't know how to treat fat people, of course.
It's like, oh my God.
Right. Oh my gosh, you got more love handles than the average person. Gosh darn it. And
got more rolls in the bakery. Like,
listen,
I got love handles. I'm part of big, like, it's big nigga season. I'm not gonna lie. Like, it's cold. People love big dudes.
Listen, I love chunky people. Fenty came out with them draws, and I saw
my grandmama. My great grandma, everybody in here got raw. Everybody big. We just all big. It's just gonna be like that.
squishy people supremacy, but the story follows her and like how her dad hates her. Well, her dad's okay to her, but her mom hates her, brother hates her, and basically just watching her grow her confidence, like taking the steps to like change her hair color, paint her nails, buy clothes that she felt pretty in. And I think other than Nick and his demon time story, that story in particular, which is I really can't think of it, I want to say it's called Bubblegum. I read it in like a intensive reading class, but oh my gosh, that book right there, it was just like, you know what, yeah,
all this, I feel this right here.
all this. I mean, it wasn't until another like college where I still actually, you know, and even still some days you look at yourself like, I don't know, I'm not feeling it, and other days you're like, yeah, you're a bad bitch. But that story I definitely hold close to my heart. It's one of those that I kind of think on like, yeah, she can dye her hair purple. Absolutely. I probably won't dye my hair purple, but you know what, sentiment is shared.
Close. Like, I'll wear something that's off colored, dude. Like, I'll do me, but I'll do that. Like, I completely understand. Like, that's fantastic. Like, I love that about reading, right? Is that like, not every time, like the big epics or the huge series that people love, they don't always have a character that you immediately identify with, right? But there are some where you can like pick out an individual person and go, you know what, I really like the way this individual handled that. I like the way that they came at it, and you know what, I'm gonna attack it with that same energy. Like, when it came to YA and just young fiction and stuff, it's probably like college age, I found a book in like a random store with an ex, and it was a book called Peter Pan Syndrome. And I was like, damn, I'm about 20, 22 at the time. I'm reading this book and it's like, oh wow, this might be me. And it's just all about like adults, like adult males, like make it to their like mid 20s, like early 30s. And you find out that they're like basically 12-year-old boys in the brain. Like, oh wow, I'm basically a 12-year-old boy in the mind. Because I love like shonen manga, shonen anime, that's all me. And most of my favorite, most influential characters were like 12 to 14 year old boys. And so that influenced the crud out of me. I was really into the House of the Scorpion series. Like, I read those. Like,
man, that's a throwback. Kind of just like sparked a thought of me.
Mexican clone of a drug lord out here. Like, I just put, like, if you ever run across my TikTok, plug.
Right.
I threw up a thing about I was like trying to dog whistle people. I was like, yeah, do you remember like House of the Scorpion? Like, this kid had it really rough. Like, organ donation, all that stuff. Really dark stuff.
Oh yeah, but also I feel like there's a lot of like, there was like edgelord books, and those are my least favorite. Like, I don't know if anybody remembers the book Eighth Grade Bites in that whole series about like the kid, he was a vampire, and basically, yeah.
This is stuff. Pause. Put me on.
So I actually pulled it up because it, like, I had to pull it up. So it's, for 13 years, Vlad aided his aunt and his best friend and kept the secret that he's a half vampire. But when his teacher is replaced by a sinister substitute, he learns that there is more to being a vampire and his parents' death than he could have guessed. That's the synopsis that's on Wikipedia. That's pretty close to what the book is about. But all I'm going to say is, if you do take the time to read Eighth Grade Bites and all the books that come after it, it's edgelord. This boy is so, so gosh darn edgy. It's 2013 Tumblr edgy. He's so edgy.
Oh, yeah. Homie's just like, I'm brooding. I'm sitting there. My mom's such a bitch.
Everything is dark and bad. But I...
The abysmal darkness of my internal soul is a miasma of murder. Like,
absolutely. With the eye chimed in.
Haven't people ever heard of...
Oh, absolutely. This guy's total edgelord. And I couldn't stand those books when I was the age appropriate enough to read them. But I recently, within the last year, during like the, I guess it wasn't the height of the pandemic, because I just realized that 2020 is actually 2 years ago now.
Yeah, right. Well, here we are.
2022 now. But in 2020, I did a lot of book buying, and I did a lot of like reading old books. It inspired me to go out and get one of like my favorite books of all time. What is it? Sunshine by Robin McKinley. Okay. And I was getting the book, and I quick side story about the book Sunshine. I have bought that book 5 times over the course of my life. The first time, it was bought for me as a gift when I was 16 years old, as a birthday gift with a Barnes & Noble gift card. I took it to IKEA and I lost it in IKEA.
Oh.
The second time I bought the book, I was 17 and I bought it with graduation money. I went to I went to Barnes & Noble's, grabbed the book, but then I had grad bash when I graduated, and then that book got wet on a ride because I carried it with me.
Wait. You were that girl? It was just like, yo, I just gotta have that book on me. Like, it's always got that thing on me. What you mean, that big old book? Like, what's up?
Right, like, period. I pulled it out and everyone's literally looking at me like, why do you have a book? So when we wait in line.
Said he wanna be my simpot. Hold me close, make a hint. Said he wanna be my simpot. Hold me close, make a hint. Said he wanna be my simpot. Hold me close, make a hint. Said he wanna be my simpot. Said he wanna be my simpot. Hold me close, make a hint talk. But I kick up like Sean and slide through like a Ronin. And you know it's one sight. Like a tag and be fight. Yo, she meant to when I slice. Play by the rules with a dice. Play by the rules with a dice. Got a couple edgy nights. I hit the blunt, yeah, I might. You just might be my type. I'm player blunt. First person shooter. He keep a shotty and I got the Ruger. I'm not a damsel, but he trying to save me. Army or two, we go back to back. Tackling Matt and I hit the sack. Trying to put all my niggas on the map. I'm dodging these lanes, but fuck what you saying. We trying to get rich. Stupid little bitch. She be so jelly. Talking all that shit. I might just fuck around and order the hair. I'm lit like Pika with my tooth. I'm the one they wanna choose. I'm drowsy with the snooze. Look like Zayda, keep confused. She made the news. Murder scene. Got you hella views. Said he wanna be my simpot. Hold me close, make a hint talk. But I kick up like Sean and slide through like a Ronin. And you know it's one sight. Like a tag and be fight. Yo, she meant to when I slice. Play by the rules with a dice. Play by the rules with a dice. Got a couple edgy nights. I hit the blunt, yeah, I might. You just might be my type. Said he wanna be my simpot. Hold me close, make a hint talk. But I kick up like Sean and slide through like a Ronin. And you know it's one sight. Like a tag and be fight. Yo, she meant to when I slice. Play by the rules with a dice. Play by the rules with a dice. Got a couple edgy nights. I hit the blunt, yeah, I might. You just might be my type. Yeah, we head to the banjo. Crash bandicoot, take the look. Getting jewels off the sand, but why you trying to cock mine though? If it's my time, let me shine, yo. I keep some missiles in the silo. In case you want problems, in case you want problems. I got niggas that follow them bullets real hollow. I got you hella sleepy hollow. I got you hella sleepy hollow. Said he wanna be my simpot. Hold me close, make a hint talk. But I kick up like a Shona, slide through like a Ronin. And you know it's on sight. Like I take and be fight. Yo, she meant to when I slice. Play by the rules with a dice. Play by the rules with a dice. Got a couple urgent nights. I hit the blunt, yeah, I might. You just might be my type. Said he wanna be my simpot. Hold me close, make a hint talk. But I kick up like Shona, slide through like a Ronin. And you know it's on sight. Like a tag and be fight. Yo, she meant to when I slice. Play by the rules with a dice. Play by the rules with a dice. Got a couple edgy nights. I hit the blunt, yeah, I might. You just might be my type.